Good morning, up at church. I loved worship this morning. Was that not awesome? Just fill me up, God. I don't know. Tony started out talking about we want to hear from God. And I think sometimes we just need to be filled up with His presence. And sometimes we don't always get what we want. Things don't always quite work out the way that we expect it to. And doesn't it always sometimes happen to you? You know, you look at your life looking back, you kind of look back and think, man, I didn't think I'd be here, you know, going through this or have to experience this. And it's kind of oddly enough, we have three different doors, and they look completely different. One is made out of solid wood, one's hollow, and this actually used to be a closet door in my bedroom growing up, and we transformed it to look like that, and which is kind of cool. It's almost like, remember the game show? You have to pick a door. I think sometimes in life we have to make these decisions and we have no idea what's behind them. But yet we're trying to make the best decision we can for a family, what God wants us to do. And we're not quite sure what's behind that door. In church, that's exactly trying to hear the voice of God is like. See, we don't always fully understand everything that lies in our path. We don't understand everything that lies before us. All we can do is try to make the best decision we possibly can with what God's given us and hear clearly from Him. And sometimes He doesn't give us all the information at that exact time. If He did, it would be an overload. So I was thinking about this morning. If God would have told me that, hey, by the time you're, you know, nearly 40, you will have pastored a brand new church for nearly 6 years, you'd be married for 18, you would have four kids, this is your life. And I'd be like, God, let me choose door number two, because door number one looks a little rough. I mean, if God was to lay it out in front of you, your life, would you accept it? See, as the time that whenever we make these decisions, when God's leading us through this life and we're making these decisions, we don't always know exactly what's behind each door. We don't always know exactly what it looks like. And we started out talking about, we had this traffic light. I like using props because I think it helps us try to retain what God's given us and we associate it with God's Word. I had somebody tell me that they're never going to look at a traffic light the same again, because you compare a traffic light to Moses hearing from God of this burning bush. Compare it to this traffic light that it's clearly, a traffic light is clear. You know when to go, you know when to stop, you know when to yield or in some case go faster. But it's clearly marked. And we said that the first week that when God speaks to you, it's going to be clear. You're going to know that it's God. When God speaks, you're going to know that it's Him. And then the next week we're talking about when God calls us, we have the supreme authority. He gives us the trump card. He gives us His name that we can go and fully, under His authority, go out and accomplish what He's laid in front of us to do. I mean, fully. And the last week we talked about if people can see the hand of God upon you. Can they see it in your life? Can they see it in your actions? Can they see this evidence of God? We compared that to Moses had this staff slash turned into a snake, and we know that it was kind of weird. But if people can look at your life, will they see the hand of God? Will they see it in action? Do they see that? And I think we're pretty good about hearing from God, and we might go forth and we might do what He says. But I think where the problem is that we don't know how often or how many times we ought to hear from God. See, whenever I call upon my girls, I expect them to answer to me every time. Yes, sir. We've got a dog. We've trained him. I'm going to holler for him, Murphy, and I tell him to come. I expect him to come every time. Not just one every other time. Not one out of every 10 times. Every time I holler for my girls, every time I holler for my dog, and I ask them to come, I expect them to respond. But I wonder how many times God calls upon us, and we just pretend like we don't hear. Have you ever done it with your parents? You may do that with your supervisor or your boss. Pretend like, oh, I'm sorry, I didn't hear you. This machinery's running. You ever do that with God? I want to do this. The other day, my girls was talking about something. I wanted no part of it. So I did this. You ever do that? I think that sometimes we do that even with God. Pretend like we don't hear it. We ignore it. I wonder how many times God has to speak to us. See, we don't just hear from God one time and just let it go. We should continually hear from God. He's our God. He's going to lead us through our life. And as He leads us and as He guides us, we're going to see His hand at work, and other people are going to see His hand at work in our lives as well. So how often do you hear from God? How often are you supposed to hear from God? Turn with me to Exodus chapter 11, and we're going to see this. And where we left off last week with these plagues of Egypt that was transpiring between Moses and Aaron and the king at that time, or he's known as Pharaoh. And all these plagues, and there were locusts, there were these flies, there were these gnats, there was the rivers and the waters turned as blood. And everybody was suffering. Everybody was having to suffer from all this stuff. And if you can imagine, all these fish have died, and what kind of smell that was like. It would have been wretched. So in Exodus chapter 11, God speaks to Moses. And here's what he tells him. This is Exodus chapter 11. This is verse 1. It said, "The Lord said to Moses, I will bring one more plague on Pharaoh and on Egypt. After that, he will let you go from here. And when he lets you go, he will drive you out of here. Now announce to the people that both men and women should ask their neighbors for silver and gold jewelry." The Lord gave the people favor in the sight of the Egyptians, and the man Moses was highly regarded in the land of Egypt by Pharaoh's officials and the people. God was telling Moses, just one more. Just one more. See, the promise has been all this time is that, hey, you guys are getting out of Egypt. I'm getting you out of slavery. You're getting out. You're getting out. You're getting out. And these plagues kept coming and coming and coming. Now, if I am Moses' people, I'm like, Moses, what's going on here? You know, what's happening? Where are we at? Because we're suffering here with all these plagues that's coming in. And sometimes we do that. We bicker and complain like, God, I just don't see you at work. I don't understand how this is quite working now. So God takes Moses and he says, Moses, just one more. Just one more plague. This is it. After this, Pharaoh's going to let you go. This is it. And he also says, not only is he going to let you go, he's going to drive you out. He's going to beg you to leave. And when he begs you to leave, whenever he's driving you out, I want you to ask all the Egyptians for all their silver and their gold, because they're actually going to pay you to leave. Now, is that not something else? They've been slaves to the Egyptians, and now they're going to get paid to leave. And there's one last key thing in this, that God has given these, all his people, favor in the sight of the Egyptians. So they favored them, but it said Moses was highly regarded. God is at work. And sometimes in your life, when you don't see God at work, that is when he's at work. I'm going to say that again. Sometimes when you can't see God at work, that's when he's at work. Let that sink in for a minute. So now it's when you can't see God at work, that's when he's at work. Because God is sometimes working behind the scenes. And you can't see it at all. Now you're going to be able to hear me. Now you have no idea what I'm doing back here, but I'm making funny faces. You still can't see me. And sometimes God is just like this. We can't see what's going on back there, but we know he's at work. Do you understand that sometimes just because you can't see God at work does not mean he's not at work? It just means that you can't see it. But there's coming a time when you will see all things. You're going to see that God at work. You're going to have all knowledge of this. You're going to understand God's plan. I'm telling you, God is at work even when you can't see it. Church, this is where our faith comes in. That we have faith to hold on to God even in the darkest of times, because there's dark times ahead of us. God begins to explain this to Moses. Flip over to Exodus chapter 12. This is the final instruction, the final plague, this final miracle. Exodus chapter 12, and it starts with verse 6. And there's a whole lot to this, but I'm just going to narrow this down to three verses. And it says, Exodus 12, verse 6, it says, "You are to keep it until the 14th day of this month. Then the whole assembly of the community of Israel will slaughter the animals at twilight. They must take some of the blood and put it on the two doorposts and on the lintel of the houses where they eat them. They are to eat the meat that night. They should eat it, roast it over fire along with unleavened bread and bitter herbs." Now, what he's giving them then, this is because is Passover instructions. This is the Passover meal. You'll see this over in the New Testament as well, and they practice this. But they're supposed to take a special sacrifice, a special animal, and they kill it, and they're going to prepare the meat. But they're supposed to gather the blood, and he says you're going to take this blood, and you're going to splatter it on both sides of the post. So on this side, and on this side and up here. Very specific. He also gave them very specific instructions about how to eat the meat over a roasted fire with unleavened bread and bitter herbs. Now, this was very specific for a specific reason. We're not going to get into that today. What we're focusing on is this sacrifice and that blood. Now, I want you to understand it's in three spots. So, both sides and on the top. Very specific. Now, if God asks you to go kill an animal and splatter the blood on your door frame, what would you say? What would you say? Now, this is, God gave these instructions to Moses. Now, he's telling to all the people, so let's pretend I'm Moses and you're the Israelites. And I tell you, thank you all for coming here today. God has gave us his final instruction. Go home, take your sacrificial animal, your goat, your lamb. You're going to slaughter it. You're going to take the blood and you're going to sprinkle it on your door. And on Wednesday, you're going to welcome trick-or-treaters. Now, would that not be weird? It seems kind of odd instruction, does it not? And sometimes God gives us weird things to do. It seems like we don't understand, but here's the point, church. We can't understand what's going on behind the scenes. We don't always see God at work. We don't understand what he's doing. And church, you don't have to understand everything to believe in something. Do you get that? We think we have to have everything figured out before we come to God. It ain't like that. We come to God and then he figures us out. He'll clean us out. He'll straighten us out. Church, if you want your life to be on track, you want your life to come together, just trust God and watch what he'll do, because he's at work behind the scenes. And some of you here today, and you've exhausted all your resources. You're tired, you're weary, you're tired of your marriage, you're tired of your family, you're tired of your job, and you just don't see God at work behind the scenes. I'm telling you, trust him and put your blood on your doors. Now, not literally, but I'm talking like faithfully. Trust God. Will you trust God when he's at work behind the scenes? This was the final instruction. So Moses goes and he speaks to all the people and he says, here's what the Lord says. This is what he says. Take it and do this. Moses doesn't ask why. He doesn't interrupt God, but God keeps speaking. Now look at verse 12. God goes ahead. He just goes ahead and just lays it on him. In verse 12, he says, I will pass through the land. Thus the name Passover. The Lord's going to pass over the land, pass through this land on that night and strike every firstborn male in the land of Egypt. And when it says strike, it means to death. I will strike every firstborn male in the land of Egypt, both man and beast. I am Yahweh. We started out the very first week talking about this name, Yahweh. Most intimate name of God means I am. There is no other God but God. He is it. I am Yahweh. And he says, I will execute judgments against all the gods of Egypt. The blood on the houses where you are staying will be a distinguishing mark for you. When I see the blood, I will pass over you, and no plague will be among you to destroy you when I strike the land of Egypt. Here's why. See, we couldn't understand the whole behind the scenes. We see it later. He says, hey, I'm going to come over at midnight. I'm coming. I'm going to pass through the land. And when I see your door and I see the blood, I'm going to pass over it. I'm not going to enter in and killed the firstborn. Now, I was somewhere around 10 years old when I first read this in Sunday school, and I was terrified because I'm the firstborn male in my house, and I thought I was going to die that night. This was in the Old Testament. You're safe. Thank goodness for Jesus, and none of this happened anymore. It's going to pass over. But only the ones that followed the instructions. God has spoken. When God speaks, do you hear? Or do you just want to understand everything? See, sometimes we're so good at just bickering and arguing back and forth. Teens, you are probably the absolute worst for this. Whenever your parents tell you something, you want to go, but why? Or do this. But I'm going to do this. No. When your parents speak as supreme authority, when God speaks as supreme authority, when God speaks, we shouldn't ask why not? Let's do this, God. I mean, could you see Moses arguing with God? God, why must we sprinkle blood? Let's put up sassafras. Let's just put some sassafras limbs or maybe some sap from a tree. Maybe that'll work. No, it took the blood. The blood from the sacrifice on each door. And then when the Holy Spirit, when this power, this judgment of God came over and it seen this, it went right by. And then we go to the next door. It didn't matter how crazy looking or how oblong looking, if the blood was applied to the side post and the lintel, the Spirit passed over it. And then it went to the next one. Went to the next one. In every house that had the blood, he did not enter in and kill the firstborn. But to the one that didn't, he went right in and executed his judgment. Now what does this mean for us? This one word in verse 13, it says, the blood on the houses where you're staying will be a distinguishing mark for you. A distinguishing mark. Now I love this word. A distinguishing mark. We asked last week, can people see the hand of God at work in your life? It should be a distinguishing mark. Church, those who have been saved were bought with the blood of Jesus. We have a distinguished mark. This doesn't mean you dress a certain way. It doesn't mean that you follow a certain guidelines, but it means that you have the Holy Spirit now entered into your house, your body, and you are no longer living for you. You're living for Jesus. A distinguishing mark. Our church, our life should be an example unto others. When people see us, they should see Jesus. They should see Jesus. What does this mean to you? I'm going to ask you right now. Do you have blood on your door? Not to your house, but to your heart. Has the blood of Jesus been applied to your heart? Has it? Church, if it has, then you're going to be a distinguished mark. You're going to be different than what you once were. You're going to find that you're at odds with yourself because there are going to be things in your life that you don't want to do, but you find yourself doing them. And you've got this tug of war in your life about who you're living for, yourself or for Jesus. That's a pretty good sign that you belong to God. Is there an example? Are you this distinguishing mark? When the Holy Spirit comes and looks at your life, what does he see? Does he see his blood? Or does he see an empty door? Well, this is what happened. They went out, they performed this. They went out, they did this sacrifice, they put the blood on the door, they ate. In verse 29, it says this, now at midnight, the Lord struck every firstborn male in the land of Egypt, from the firstborn of Pharaoh who sat on his throne to the firstborn of the prisoner who was in the dungeon, and every firstborn of the livestock. Church, this was thousands of deaths. And it happened just as he said. At midnight, Holy Spirit came, swooped by the door. If the blood was there, he passed on. But if the blood was not there, he went in. And it took every firstborn from every household and every, I love this, livestock. The firstborn, even the animals suffered. Even the animals suffered. But the key to this was, is that the entire family would be in the house. The entire family. The entire family was saved because of the actions of the father. This was the male's role to prepare his house, to save his household. And those that had the blood were saved. Those that did not have the blood were not saved. So you can imagine what kind of panic happened. Look at verse 30. During the night, Pharaoh got up. He, along with all his officials and the Egyptians, and there was a loud wailing throughout Egypt because there wasn't a house without someone dead. He summoned Moses and Aaron during the night, and he said, get up, leave my people, both you and the Israelites, and go. Worship Yahweh as you have asked. Take your flocks and your herds as you have asked and leave. And he says this, and also bless me. Even Pharaoh himself recognizes the hand of God. I want you to bless me. Take your people and go. Get out of here. Leave. Now, the Lord predicted this. He said, here's what's going to happen. Pharaoh's going to drive you out. Here's what he's doing. He's begging them to leave. He's urging them, get out of here. It's time. All this is happening. The church, they couldn't see this from behind the scenes. See, whatever God's at work behind the door, we can't see. But get this. So here they are. All they did was have the blood applied, right? Everybody's inside the house. They don't know what's going on outside. They had to keep the doors shut. There was no peeping around. Like, you know, you want to crack the door and see what's going on out there. We do this when it's weather outside, don't we? We see if it's snowing, we'll crack the door and we'll just peek and like, man, it's cold. Or you hear an animal outside and you peek out and you're like, oh, it's just a cat or whatever, and you're peeking outside. They couldn't do that. They had to keep the door shut while God was at work. So two examples of not being able to see God at work. One, they couldn't sit in front of them, and the other, they were behind the door, protected by the blood. Church, you're not always going to see God at work, but they heard something. They heard something. And it says in verse 30, there was a loud wailing. Could you imagine thousands of households and everyone at midnight realizing that someone in their house was dead? How much wailing this would be? How much crying, shouting? How much sorrow? It was so loud, they heard it all throughout the land of Egypt, and everybody that had the blood applied, they even heard it in their homes, and they had to keep the door shut. Keep the door shut. Until it was over. And then Pharaoh calls up Moses and Aaron. He says, guys, get out of here, you and all your people. Get out of here. Go worship your God. He calls him Yahweh. Go worship your God. Get out of here. Flee. Bless me. I think he's just done. At this point, he's just done. He wants out of it. He wants them to leave. He wants no more of this. No more of the sorrow. No more of this death. Because even this death angel visited his house. So now they have a choice to do. An act of faith. See, all this was leading up to this one point to where they could leave. Remember, they're slaves. They're there being abused, overworked. They're there trapped. And now they are free to go. So Moses and Aaron gets to go and tell everybody, guys, pack your stuff up. It's time to go. Look at this verse. It's verse 35. So the Israelites acted on Moses' word and asked the Egyptians for silver and gold jewelry and for clothing. And the Lord gave the people such favor in the Egyptians' sight that they gave them what they requested. In this way, they plundered the Egyptians. So as they were leaving, they would see this Egyptian. They're like, hey, I like your gold dangle bracelet. They would go, here you go. I like that gold chain. Here you go. Your silver cup. I like that. Here you go. So they were giving all this stuff away. They were asking for, and they had such favor with the Egyptians that they let them take it. And it said, plundered. They gave all their stuff away to the Israelites as they left. So the Egyptians, not only did they drive them out, they paid them to leave. They paid them to go. Wouldn't you like to get paid to go on a vacation? Or wouldn't it be, you were slaves for all these. They've been slaves for over 400 years. They've been slaves to the Egyptians for over 400 years. And now they have the opportunity to leave and get paid for it. You tell me what God can't do in your life. If God can do something like this, can orchestrate something this extravagant, don't you think God can orchestrate something powerful in your life? Church, I don't think God's done with you yet. You may look at your life and all you see, and it's why I got this funky door. It's a trifold door. It used to be into a closet. It's still a door. It's not a front door, but it's still a door. And I put a light behind it because some of you, you don't see a nice door. You don't see a nice life. When you look at your life, you see something that looks a little more scarred. Maybe a wild past. Maybe a bunch of decisions that haven't turned out quite the way you had anticipated. Church, I'm telling you, it doesn't matter. God's not done with you yet. It doesn't matter what you see in your life or what kind of past that you see. God's not done with you yet. See, they got to leave and they got to go and they got their finances paid for. They got to take all this plunder. It says, in this way, they plundered the Egyptians. They took all they had. They took all that they had. Look at verse 50. It says this. Then all the Israelites did this. They all did it. The Israelites were saved. They all did this. They did, and this is important, just as the Lord had commanded Moses and Aaron. On that same day, the Lord brought the Israelites out of the land of Egypt according to their divisions. They brought them out. This was the promise that they were going to get out. And they heard the commands of God. Now, God spoke to Moses and Aaron. They heard the commands of God. They heard this voice of God. And they obeyed. And because they obeyed, they got to keep their life. Their firstborn son got to live. Their firstborn cow got to live. And now they're on their way leaving Egypt. And they got paid for it. not just a little. It says plunder. They got paid a lot. A lot. But they all did it. They all did it. They didn't come up to Moses and go, "Moses, I think I need a new door before Jesus comes." No, they took what they had, sprinkled the blood on it, and it saved them. Church, you don't clean up your life before you come to God. You let Him do all that. The blood covers a multitude of sins. And a multitude is a number that cannot be counted. Can't be counted. Now you ask me what God can't do in your life. Church, I'm telling you, you're here today, you're living, you're breathing, God's not done with you yet. Sometimes it seems like it's so bleak that we can't figure out what God's doing next. And it's just like looking at what's going on behind that door. You can't see what's going on behind that door. But maybe you ain't supposed to. Just trust God and do what He says. Church, I'm convinced that we can sum up all the Bible into that. Just trust God and do what He says. Trust God and do what He says. Is God speaking to you in your life? Has God been speaking to you? And maybe it's fallen deaf ears, or maybe you haven't really wanted to listen to it, or maybe you've made excuses. Is God leading you to do something with your life? Or maybe He's wanting you to break out of your comfort zone. Is God leading you to do something? And you're like, "But you don't understand. It sounds so absurd." Is it more absurd than going and killing a goat and sprinkling its blood on your door? I mean, does that not sound absurd? But if God tells you to do something, He's giving you the trump card, and we should do it. Church, we should do it. We should do it. When God speaks, we should respond. "God, here I am. What do you want me to do? Let's go. I'll do it. Let's go." Is God leading you to do something? Maybe God's trying to speak in your life and He's wanting you to surrender to Him. That you've been coming to church and everybody thinks you got a good-looking door. Swings both ways. It opens, it shuts. You've even got a fancy lock on it. God don't care about any of this. He cares what's on the inside. He cares what's on the inside. When He saved the Israelites from this death angel, He didn't care about the door. He cared what was behind the door. I don't think He cares about your exterior, your sin, your past. He cares what's inside. Do you have the blood of Jesus applied to your heart? If your answer to that is yes, then that is fantastic. Then now you have a role to do. You have a responsibility to do. Because church, there's some of us that God is leading to do something. We sing a song all the time whenever we were growing up called "Trust and Obey." And maybe you heard that. It was an old hymn. We sing out of those red hymn books, "Trust and Obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey." Trust and obey. Now I'm going to put it in P.J. Johnson's words. Listen to God and do what He says. Is God leading you in your life right now to do something? It may be extravagant. It may be very small. It does not matter. Because you find in the New Testament, Jesus gave a parable of these different talents. One gave 1, 5, 10. They had these different talents. And He came back and He asked them of those talents, like what they did with them. And here's what He said to one of them. This is Matthew chapter 25, verse 23. He says this. His master said to him, "Well done, good and faithful slave. You were faithful over a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Share in your master's joy." Now, I like this because the HCSB says faithful slave. That puts a different twist on it than it does servant. See, when we're a slave to something, it means that we have given all of ourselves over to it. This is not in a negative context. It's in a positive context. This means that we are a master to Jesus. He is our master. We are His slave. He is our master. We are His servants. We are to trust and obey. Well, there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. Here's, I think, some of you right now that you've been on like on a fence, been flip-flopping, wondering where you stand with God. Well, there's two points to this. Either you're saved or you're not. Let's nail this down. Are you saved? Do you have the blood of Jesus? Have you accepted Jesus Christ as your Savior? Church, there's no no. There's a no and there's a yes. There's no maybe. There's not a I don't know. There's not a I hope I am, or one day we're going to find out. Because you're right, one day we will find out. It's a knowing way, yes or no. And church, if you have any doubt whatsoever, church, I'm telling you, it's time to nail that down. Where there is a hard yes and a hard no. That you know exactly where you stand with God. If God was to come today and look at you, your heart right now, what would He see? Would He see the blood? Or would He see a blank door? Daniel, will you cut these lights off right here? Not these, those. Thank you. All right, it says that the Spirit came at midnight. So I just wanted to kind of simulate this. This Holy Spirit came at midnight. And when it came at midnight, this Holy Spirit, this death angel came and it searched out every single door. And as it searched out all these doors, it was looking for one thing and one thing only. No good intentions. It wasn't looking for any excuses. It wasn't looking for any type of specific door. It was looking for one thing and one thing only. And that was this sacrificial blood that was applied to both the left and the right and the top. The left, the right, and the top. Church, it's midnight. And the Holy Spirit is coming. When the Holy Spirit comes right now, what does He find at your door? Does He find the blood, or does He find no blood? Church, it's a yes or it's a no. Just as it's so plainly to see the blood on the door, it's evident, it's clear, it's very plain and clear to see when it's not there. Church, nobody can answer this question for you. This is one that has to be answered by you and you alone. Is the blood applied to your door? To your heart? Have you accepted Jesus Christ as your Savior? Have you accepted Jesus Christ as your Savior? Some of you, it's yes. Yes, you've got the blood applied. It's been there for years, and praise God for you. Would you take a moment right now and pray for someone else in here that may not? Would you do that with me? If you are saved, you know beyond a shadow of a doubt you are saved. Would you take a moment and pray for someone else that may be not? There's other of you in here, and you know that you don't have the blood applied. Your door looks this. There's no blood applied, and you know it. You know that you've never accepted Jesus Christ as your Savior. Or maybe you've been wishy-washy. Maybe you thought you did, but you've not. And it's time to nail that down. I encourage you to take a moment right now and pray and ask God to save you. Would you take a moment right now and would you pray with me? Let's pray together. Father God, we pray right now that You'd search us out. And just as the Holy Spirit moved that night at midnight, God, we're asking right now that the power of Your Holy Spirit would move through this room. And God, that we'd feel Your presence. And that, God, You would just speak, Father, clearly. And it would be so evident, so vivid, so loud, and so clear, God, that we would know beyond a shadow of a doubt that it's You that's stirring right here in this room. Father, I pray. God, I pray that You would search us out right now and reveal to us right now where we stand in Your eyes. We either have the blood or we do not. Those of you who are saved, I'm asking you to take a moment right now and pray for someone else that's not. Maybe someone you know that's not saved. Maybe someone that's in here that's not saved. Would you pray for them right now? Pray for them right now. There's those of you in here, maybe you've been wishy-washy, maybe you've not for sure, maybe you've not nailed it down. Maybe this is the first time you've come back to church in years, and it's time to rededicate your life to God and say, you know what, I'm giving all myself to God, and I know beyond a shadow of a doubt, I am making sure that blood is applied to my heart. And we're taking care of that right now. Church, if you're here today, you've not accepted Jesus Christ, would you pray right now? Just call on God right now. Call on Him to save you. Call out to Him, say, God, save me. from my sins. I accept Jesus Christ as my Savior. And I believe that He died on a cross and rose again for me, my sins. I know I've been wicked. I know that I've been far from God. But today, I'm a new creation. Because I'm giving it all to Jesus. Let Him wash me white as snow. That my sins are being forgiven and thrown into a sea of forgetfulness. As far as the east is from the west, so are my sins in the presence of God. Gone. Forgotten. I believe in Jesus. As you continue to pray, there's some of you who prayed that prayer right now, and I want to take a moment to welcome you into the family of God. There's those of you here today that God is speaking to you. He's speaking to you and He's wanting you to move. You're tired of living the same old life, the mediocre life. It's time to be an example in your household. That anytime someone comes in your door, they're going to see and experience a sight of God that they've never experienced before. That your marriage is going to experience a sight of God that nobody's ever seen before. That your job and that your future, that your finances can see and can be an example unto other people of what kind of God it is that you serve. That when people look at you, they can look through you right to your heart. And just as the death angel is looking for that blood, people are going to be able to see an example of God through you. Church, if God is speaking to you today, in leading you to do something, it's time that we obey. It's time that we trust and obey. We trust Him with our heart, we trust Him with our life, and we trust Him. Even though we can't see everything, even though we can't see the future, even though we can't tell exactly what's going on behind the scenes, we're going to trust Him. Church, if God is speaking to you and leading you to do something, maybe you know what it is and maybe you don't. I don't think that's the important part. I think the important part is knowing that God is speaking and leading you to do something. You may not know what the something is. I think that's okay. We can figure that out. But I think what's important is knowing that God is speaking and He's speaking to you and it's time for you to move. Church, if God is speaking to you today and He is wanting you to do something, I don't care what it is, something. And we have these lights off and we're simulating it's midnight. I'm going to ask if you would be bold enough to take this first step and just come to this altar and say, okay, God, I know You're leading me to do something. I'm coming to this altar. I may know what it is. I may not know what it is, but I'm just going to lead in Your hands, God. I'm just going to trust You. You know what it is. If God is speaking to you to move and act in your life, whatever it may be, would you come to this altar today and just say, God, here I am. I take the first step. Here I am. If God is speaking to you today, leading you to do something in your life, then I'm going to encourage you to take this moment and come and respond by coming to this altar. If God is speaking to you, would you come? Some's coming. God's leading them to do something. I'm asking if there's somebody else. God is leading you to do something. You may know what it is. You may not know what it is. Just come to the altar and say, God, I'm taking the first step. Just taking the first step. Nobody's looking around. It's between you and God. Playing an awesome song, Amazing Grace. And if God is speaking to you today, I encourage you to come. There's those of you here today that God is speaking. Maybe in a way that's disturbing. It's our prayer that you're going to walk out here different today. Have a clear ear to hear when God speaks. That you might be able to move and do exactly what He'd have you to do. Some of you got things going on in your life right now. I'm going to pray for you. We're just going to pray together. I'm going to ask if you would. right now, the person next to you, would you just touch the person next to you, whoever it may be, to your left, to your right, you just touch the person next to you and pray for that person. Just touch the person next to you, whoever that is. It may be a stranger. It may be your friend. It may be your spouse. It may be your mother, your daughter. Whoever it is, would you just touch the person next to you? Would you just uplift them in prayer? If you find yourself in a seat that nobody's next to you, then I encourage you to pray for the person in front of you or behind you. Whoever that is, would you touch that person? Would you pray for them? See, church, you have no idea what goes on behind their door. You don't know what kind of lifestyle that there is there. You don't know what kind of peace or disruption. You're going to take this moment and pray for that other person. Whatever it is they've got going on. Let's pray together. God, we thank you, Father, for being an awesome, great, powerful God. For loving us and knowing exactly what we need and when we need it. Today, Father, we're uplifting the person and we're touching. We ask, God, that you do a great work in them and through them. God, we pray that you'd give them the kind of faith that Moses and Aaron had, that whenever you spoke, they didn't ask any questions, they just acted. And it didn't matter how ridiculous it sounded or how absurd, they just done it. Father, may we have the same peace, the same faith, that whenever you speak to us, Father, we can move. God, we uplift the person to you that we're touching right now. We ask, God, that you do a great work in them and through them, that they're going to have this type of faith just like Moses and Aaron. They're going to walk out of these doors different, Father, than when they came in. And I pray, God, that we would be an example unto others, that whenever they look at us, they could see the blood of Jesus. They could see you at work. Because God, I believe with all my heart that you're not done with us yet and you're not done with this person. And I pray, God, that you'd fill them up with so much of your Holy Spirit that's going to overflow, and that anytime somebody sees them, they're going to see Jesus. Help us, Father, that we continue to uplift these people in our lives and what you're doing. Because you're not dead. You're still at work. In the powerful name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Would you take a moment, give God some awesome praise? God, I love you.